Hoyo we. Huyo ni bibi ya mwenyewe. Hoyo we. Huyo ni bibi ya mwenyewe. Hi, I'm Jeremy Goldkorn for Danwei TV, sitting in the home of Zhang Lijia, who has just published her memoir in English. It's called Socialism is Great. It's a story about her life as a worker in a missile factory from 1980 to 1990. Lijia, maybe you can tell me how you started working at the factory and how old you were when that happened.
I was 16, that was 1980. My mother just dragged me out of school and put me at work because that was just a few years after the Cultural Revolution and the unemployment was running really high. There was a temporary policy which allowed children to take over the job if parents retired. So my mother decided to take that advantage of that policy. You know, we were very poor, obviously. So I had grand plans for myself. I wanted to be a writer, a journalist, but at 16, I ended up at the factory.
Doing manual labour?
Manual labour, and I have to say, I wasn't a rocket scientist.
Right. But the factory actually made missiles, intercontinental missiles?
Yes, among other things, yes. That's called Feast product.
Right, okay. Can you explain the title? Why is it called Socialism is Great?
Socialism is Great. Actually, it's the title of a song we had to sing every year on July 1st. That was party's birthday. We had a revolutionary songs competition. So this one of the must sing songs was Socialism is Great.
社会主义好，社会主义好。 Okay. What about, one of the things that's interesting about this book, I think, there have been a lot of memoirs, especially in English, by Chinese people about their experiences in the Cultural Revolution, or even before Great Leap Forward, a lot of tales of really terrible suffering and bitterness. But one of the enjoyable things about your book is that although it's a very closed society you describe, it's not actually desperate suffering. It's actually quite a happy story. Nonetheless, the 80s were very different from now. You didn't have a lot of personal space or choice in your life. Can you describe maybe what it was like to work at a Danwei, a state-owned work unit?
Right, okay. But anyway, to just follow what you just said, and when I decided to write the book, I did do some research and I discovered, although the market has been flooded by China memoir, but most memoirs are bitter suffering tales during the Cultural Revolution or before. Very few memoirs set in the 80s. While 80s, I believe, is the most fascinating period because that's just when things began to change. Deng Xiaoping introduced reform, which effectively transformed China. And in many ways, that's, a time China became what it is today. So this is very much my personal story. So my personal journey reflects what China went through in the 80s. And also, as you said, and I promise you, this is not another bitter suffering tale, but more upbeat about pursuing your dreams of breaking the boundary. Your question is what's my life like?
No problem, yeah. So, I mean, can you describe a typical day in the life of a 1980s Danwei, like, for your eyes?
Well, I told people, especially Western friends, that I worked at a missile factory for 10 years, and people always say, wow, fascinating, but fascinating, that's not the word I would use. And my experience then was really mind-numbing, so destroying. I mean, today, China and Chinese people enjoy a lot more personal freedom, but back in those days, there was just so much control. I mean,
so you wake up at what time?
I wake up early in the morning. So 6:30 or something like that. And I'll just my whole life was really confined.
You living inside the factory?
No, I lived in the factory compound.
In the factory compound.
Yes.
How long would it take you to walk, or would you ride a bike?
I cycled. I have to stress. My factory was very much a mini communist state, providing workers with identical block buildings and feeding us at a dining hall and cleaning us at a bath houses. So, I stayed at this one of the block buildings belonged to the factory, and I
ride
my bike to work and, had at the dining hall.
Do you have come to back clock in at that time, or what time would you, you know, was there control of the time you
were arriving? Yes, well, yes, there were guards, and then if we were late, sometimes people were sending people to catch you if you're late. So.
Right.
We wouldn't dare to be late.
And you'd work from what time? Nine?
From eight. Yes, you know, 8 to 5:30, and it was 1 hour, roughly, you know, 1 hour break in
at
between.
Lunch in so those workers'
canteen. Yes, yeah. Right. So just, you know, and then come back home. You know, if I wanted to go to bath, you know, clean myself. Still, the bus house run by the factory. So. And many workers intermarry, and then their children will go to the kindergarten and run by the factory. So originally, my working title was called A Frog in a Well. That's a drama story. It's about this frog being trapped in the bottom of the well, couldn't see the world beyond. So
a little tiny piece of the sky.
So yeah. I just very much feel, you know, for 10 years, I was just a frog being trapped at the bottom of the factory well. And so, and also just so much control, you know, like as you can imagine, Danwei, you know, China, you know, was a very controlled society, especially at a factory, state-owned factory, like, you know, the long list of things not to do, you know, high heel shoes, lipsticks, of course, and, you know, hair even, and nothing was personal.
They control the way you cut your hair?
Well, men, of course, the hair shouldn't be longer over the earlobes.
Mm.
And I had natural wavy hair. For 10 years I worked at a factory. I never got any promotion because my big boss thought I curled my hair. And in those days, only people with bourgeoisie outlook in life were permed. So obviously I didn't have the right ideology, and I didn't deserve a promotion. And you know, can you imagine the period? And it was, can you get more private than period? And even that was subject to control. And every month we have to queue up to show the so-called period police, and virtually to show blood to see we were not pregnant.
Mm.
And then we will get a bag of a sanitary towel. It was all done in the name of looking after female workers' social welfare, but effectively part of the strict family planning.
Well, times certainly have changed.
Yes, certainly.
Thankfully. Zhang Lijia's new book, Socialism is Great, is available at a bookstore near you, depending on where you are, and also on the internet. Thanks very much, Lijia, for talking to us.
My pleasure. Hi, I'm Lijia Zhang, author of Socialism is Great. Sorry, I'm going to be looking at a lens this time. Hi, I'm Lijia Zhang, author of